Hello, this is Tao of the Heart. I'm Crystal Meech, and I have a very special guest today, Kahan Tazadaq. And it's great. Thank you so much for coming on. And I'm going to give a little background on how I came upon Kahan. So I was doing research on The Wizard of Oz. It's quite a few years ago now, probably like 3 or 4 years ago. And he had a video about The Wizard of Oz, and I seriously felt like I was Dorothy going into Oz. And I had to know more about your work. And that led me down a very interesting rabbit hole that changed my life. And so I want to read a passage, and the passage is actually from the Bible, Revelations chapter 21, verse 16. And I think that's really going to set the tone for our discussion. So, here we go. And the city lieth four. Yep. Verse 16.
Okay.
And the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are equal. And when I think of this verse, I think of the truth.
Okay.
And the truth is non-invertible. And when I went through your work, specifically, and I'm looking at the plug here, but I also have Red Pill Right Knowledge. But your work, when I think of that, I think of the truths that you have put out there in your work, and how it's non-invertible. Like, no matter how you look at it, it's the truth. And so so we're gonna go into the plug. So he created this book, and I think it might be flipped around. Yep. And you talk about in here about the Geneva conventions and about how contract is law and law is contract. You say that all the time, right?
All the time.
And so can you speak a little bit about how that truth it resonates in relationships, it resonates in business, in every part of your life? Because I think that's really the what our listeners would they need to know, like at the end of the day.
All right. So essentially, like any type of relationship is a relationship, right? Despite whether or not it's intimate, business relationship, friend relationship. So it's all a relationship. And I can't think of anything that governs our lives more than contracts, right? When you think about it, every day that we live, everything that we're engaged into involves a contract. Now, relationships, you could have what is known as a marital contract, right? But even prior to the marriage, there's still a contract. So contracts could come in many different forms. It could be express, it's expressed with a certain action, or it could be implied with a certain action, or it could be written, or it could be viva voce, meaning by voice. So all of those are a form of contract, and they're all binding if we could actually enforce them. So in a relationship, so I think there's like a type of adhesion contract, right? In relationships, that everyone that actually enters a relationship, they expect the counterpart to be loyal, right? They don't anticipate someone going out and being disloyal and engaging in, you know, infidelity or something of that nature, right? So even though that may not be expressed, it's like, it's implied with certain suggestions. And it's like, one of these things is like, supposedly automatically understood. I think we're all taught that, to be loyal in, you know, relationships. But that engagement, like if I say, hey, we're courting now, we're dating, I like essentially expect you to be just totally loyal to me. I think we all, for the most part, profess that type of belief in a relationship. So that's a contract, even though it may, I mean, some people will get slick or you know, I guess like sort of like deceptive and say, well, you didn't tell me that. But it's like one of those things that's actually understood. And so an example of something that's understood, right? Like when we're children, if we do something that we know we shouldn't be doing, we'll do it in a dark place, or we'll go and do it in a closet, right? If we knew that that was okay and we thought it was okay, we do it out in the open where everyone could actually see us. But since we're doing it where we can't be seen, so we consciously know what we're doing is wrong. So it's the same thing in that kind of engagement of a relationship. People know that they shouldn't go outside of the relationship without the consent of the other. Now, if you're going into an open-end relationship, then you should articulate that to, you know, your partner in the beginning so they'll know what to expect. So you have a contract there that's like really implied. It doesn't necessarily need to be expressed. And so in the job world, right, the job application is a contract, right? So now if I'm working on a job, let's say I'm working for Merrill Lynch. If I'm working for Merrill Lynch, once I sign that job application and they employ me, they have like a rule book, right? Which is contractual, right? It doesn't apply to me if I exist outside of that particular organization. But anyone that works for Merrill Lynch, they're obliged to follow those contracts, you know, the rules, right? Which is actually a contract, right? Some people call it an agreement, but it's really still a contract, right? And so if I violate the terms of that contract, I could be actually fired or disciplined or what have you. And so, and it goes on. Let's say if we're taking our sons or daughters to school and we register them. So when we register them for a school, it involves a contract. So now that we register them, and by the way, when you look at the word register in the legal language, it essentially means to surrender title or to surrender ownership, right? So when we register them for school, now if I wanted to go over and take my son or daughter out of school earlier than the dismissal time, then I have to sign them out. So I have to get approval from someone because I register them. And when I register them, there's like a contract, even though it's not readily revealed. It's known as an adhesion contract that we're agreeing to, right, with the registration of the children. So if we go in and just take them out, they could call the police. Why? Because now you breached the terms of the contract. So, and this goes on throughout our lives, no matter what it is, there's nothing that governs our life more than contract. And so when people, you know, you've often heard the aphorism, ignorance of the law is no excuse. But if we replace that word law with contract, it'll make more sense. Because there's so many different statutes, codes, rules, regulations that they call law, right? And so there's no way we could not be ignorant of some, right? But if we replace the word law with contract and say ignorance of the contract is no excuse, it'll make more sense. Because now I'm only obliged to this particular contract. While I can't understand all of the laws, UCC codes, US codes, I can like understand the terms of that contract. So this is why I replace the word contract with law and say contract is law and law is contract. Because if you understand the contract, then that is the law. Most times that people go to court or something is they breach some sort of contract. Some sort of agreement has been like violated. So that's my, what I have to say about that.
Yes. And that right there is like the pill, the red pill of the realization of all the contracts that you took on, but you don't necessarily know the terms. And once you become aware of that, you also realize how you gave up your authority, your own authority, to others, and you didn't even know it. And I think that affects people in so many different ways. And once you go through that, it changes your relationships because now you're consciously aware. Like, you know, what did I really sign off on? And this goes all the way back to the birth certificate.
Right.
And can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, yeah. So it goes to the birth certificate and the marriage certificate. So since you specialize in relationships, let's start with the marriage certificate. So when we actually engage in a marital contract, what's happening is we're creating a trust, right? So we're creating a trust with the state. Even if you get married through the church system, most churches are 501c3 churches, which means that they've contracted with the state. So even if you get married through the state or a preacher, what the preacher does is he send that over to the Department of State. And so it's still, registered through the state. And so what happens is the state now has legal authority over that particular marriage. So you've set up a trust. You have equitable rights in that particular trust, but the state has the legal right, which is actually the most important. It's the smallest portion of it, but if I have equitable rights, I get to use it. I get to do the things that I want to do if I follow the rules of the state. Right? It's kind of like a car from the DMV. Like once we register that, the state has legal title. I have equitable title. I get to use the car, but the state gets to tell me you got to register it. You got to put plates on it. You got to have insurance. If you don't, then we get to come in and we'll take the car away from you. So it's the same thing with the marital contract. Once we get married through the state, like the state could come in and say, well, you're not disciplining your children as the state so likes, because you spank your child. And now since you spank your child with the registration of the birth certificate, we're going to send CPS over, one of our state agents, and they're going to take little Johnny out of the home until you take some parenting classes and learn how to acknowledge the child rights. They have something known as rights of the child, which pretty much gives the child the ability to almost do what they want to do in this day and age, right? So you can't discipline your children. And so now if you can't discipline your children, the state gets to send out its minions later, like a police officer. If your children are not disciplined and they have thrown them in the box, which leads to what? It leads to commerce. Or everything is pretty much 27 CFR 72.11, all crimes are commercial. That means everything that we're actually engaged in is commerce, is commercial, even a marital contract. According to the Bible, you initially started off with the Bible. in the Bible, you didn't need any kind of third party intervener like a preacher or a priest to marry you. It was just the man and the woman. And then once her hymen was broken, like that was the consummation of the marriage, right? There was no third party. So when we bring a third party in, we're literally giving them legal authority over that marriage, right? So the birth certificate, you go to the birth certificate. So, and this is going to sound like deranged to a lot of people, but if you look at the birth certificate, it's created on bond paper. Most people don't think that has any kind of significance. And if you listen to the mainstream, they'll tell you that people that think like this are crazy. But I contend in the land of the insane, the sane is deemed to be insane. So everything is kind of topsy-turvy. But the birth certificate is created on bond paper. And you can make this parallel to like a ship. When it's come in, anyone that's actually been in the military, the Navy. So when the ship goes in and it's tied to the dock, that is known as berthing a ship. So the ship is bringing in all of these goods and commodities, right? So that the admiral of the ship has what is known as a certificate of manifest, right? And that certificate of manifest tells you everything, all of the commodities that's actually on that ship. And so the ship got there because it came in on a current, from which comes currency. And so it's the same thing with the woman. And, you know, when she's bringing forth birth, the baby comes in on her water. It's stated that when her water breaks, she's about to give birth, right? So when her water breaks, what does she do? She go in to the dock, just like the ship goes into the dock. The ship goes into the dock because it's giving birth. You're birthing the ship. The mother goes into the dock because she's bringing birth, right? And so shortly after the baby is born, then some nurse or someone comes out and they offer her to fill out what is known as a live record of birth. And so that live record of birth eventually becomes what is known as a birth certificate once it's sent over to the Department of Vital Statistics. But on that live record of birth, she's listed as an informant. Even if she's married, they don't want her marital name. They want the mating name. And so why the mating name? Why not the married name? She's married. Because as you and I know, any son or daughter, they call them children, that doesn't have a father is referred to as a bastard. So essentially, when she signs that live record of birth, she's signing her son or daughter over to the state. She's giving the state authority right there, right? And since the child is considered to be a bastard, the state assumes the responsibility of being the father. So now, if somewhere down the line she decides to discipline the child, goes against what the state wants, the state sends in CPS or whatever it's called in your particular state, and they take the child away. But she agreed to it because the birth certificate is a contract. And also, when they're presenting that live record of birth, they also ask her to fill out the Social Security application, which is also a contract. So that's a way of tracking, right? And so with the Social Security and the birth certificate, they create something known as an estate, but they don't refer to it as that. And the estate is known as a Treasury Direct Account. Now, since no one is actually appointed to be the executor of that particular estate, the mother's not appointing anyone, the father's not appointing anyone, the state appoints an attorney to manage that estate as executor. So now, as the child grows up, like, and the child thinks that it's earning some sort of funds, because with the birth certificate, under Franklin Delano Roosevelt, all real money, which is according to the Constitution, just gold or silver, right, was taken out of circulation. That was known as the money order on March the 5th, 1933, under Franklin Delano Roosevelt. So all money was taken out. But when the money was taken out, they had to give a remedy or it would be considered fraud. So the remedy, what they provided, was House Joint Resolution 192. Public law, because people say, well, that's a House Joint Resolution. Resolutions change. Okay, well, it's backed by Public Law 7310. And you could also find it in the UCC codes as, 15 USC, I believe, let me see, 18 USC 5081, no, 31 USC 5118, 31 USC 5118, I believe it is. So it's in many places. And what it states is that since they took money out of circulation, real money, which is gold and silver, then they would pay for everything dollar for dollar on the public sector. That means they will cover all of our debts dollar for dollar in the public sector. So the birth certificate, unless we take control of it, the state appoints an executor to control it. And so when we're out and we're actually working to earn a living, we're really just like paying ourselves, because that comes from our signature, since there's no real money, in our energy. So the workers are the real source of money right now, because the only thing that really exists is money of an account. And so that sounds crazy until, like, if you've actually ever had your credit compromised, right? That happened to me once. I swiped my card in Florida and someone in California was withdrawing funds from the account. So I contact PayPal and say, hey, there's $5,000 missing from my account. And they say, well, it's obviously not true because you just checked in Florida. So I think they probably used a scanner or something. And within a few hours, the money, well, what they referred to as money, was actually restored into the account. Why? Because there was nothing tangible, right? So no one really lost anything. It was just money of an account. So they just went to a computer and punched in some numbers. But it was nothing tangible, like gold or silver. So there is no money. I mean, I can understand it, believe it or not, but there's really no money. So, and all of this is actually tied into the birth certificate, which is a contract, and the Social Security, which is a contract. So the Social Security, the front is always public, the back is always private. So the number on the front essentially belongs to the straw man. The back, when you look at the back of it, there's a letter followed by some numbers. That letter points you to the Federal Reserve Bank that's actually holding your treasury account. And the number behind it, if you add two zeros, points you to the account number. So you have a routing number, same thing you need to start direct deposit, right? If I went into Chase Bank and I wanted to start direct deposit with my job, they're gonna ask me for two things. They're gonna ask me for the routing number to the bank that identifies the bank, and they will ask me for the account number. They could direct deposit the fiat right into my account. But so the birth certificate is the contract from which all other so-called identifications come from. If I need a driver's license, if I need a CDL, if I need anything, that birth certificate is the primary document that she signed off on, which is a contract. So it all goes back to contracts again. It was kind of long, but yeah.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. The thing about, and if we're tying this back to relationships, is once you become aware that, hey, this birth certificate was a contract and you were a baby when this contract went down, and then you're 18 and you kind of like consent to it because you don't even know that it's a contract, then say you get into a relationship and a marriage, again, you're signing away your authority, and you don't even know it. I guess my question is for the viewers, like, do you realize how that affects your energy and how you show up in life? And maybe you can speak to that, and in unwinding and becoming aware consciously of how the system works.
Right. So, because I was not the legal age of majority when mom and dad signed the contract for me to get a social security and for me to get the birth certificate. Once I become the legal age of majority, in some states, it's different. Some states, it used to be 16. Some states, it's 17. But for most states now, it's 18. So once I become the legal age of majority, I'm no longer obliged to that contract and the birth certificate. But what are we taught to do? We're taught to go out and get a job or a job or just over broke. Remember, Job lost everything. So he went out and got a just over broke, a job. And so when we get a job, what must we do? We have to fill out an application for a contract. But they also teach us that we have to complete a W-2, W-4, right? And so at the end of the year, what do? We got to file a 1040. And so the 1040, even if I'm now the legal age of majority, what I just did was put myself right back into the system. Because once I become 18, if I don't work, if I don't sign the 1040 or any of that, then I'm not recontracting with the state. But I myself just voluntarily recontracted with the state. So now all of these things, I just confirmed that, hey, I still want to be a debtor. So essentially, most people think that if you have a notice on most applications that you fill out, it'll ask you, are you a U.S. citizen? Why are they asking that? Because they already know, right? They already know that we're U.S. citizen because I have an ID saying that, right? I have a birth certificate saying that. So you got to think, why would they ask that? They're asking that because they're giving you the opportunity to opt out. What if I put, no, I'm not a U.S. citizen. I'm an American, right? Which would actually make me an American national. So essentially, we have two citizenships. We have a dual citizenship, but no one ever teaches us this, right? So the first citizenship is you're born an American, I'm an American. But with the birth certificate, a new citizenship is created known as a U.S. citizen. And a U.S. citizen is not what we was taught in geography class, right? We're thinking that, oh yeah, well, I'm a citizen of the 50 states united. That's not what that means. When they refer to a U.S. citizenship, they're referring to 28 U.S.C. 3002, subsection 15A, which is a federal corporation. So now, essentially what I'm saying is I'm a citizen of the District of Columbia, which is a 10 square mile radius, not of the 50 states united. It's not that U.S. that it's talking about. And if you read the Constitution, which most people don't, it's always making a distinction between the United States and the several states. Why is it making that distinction? Because the United States is the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., which is a corporation. It is not referring to the 50 states united. And so this is why at the inception of the creation of the United States, every state had its governor. And the governor was the head of your state. That was like the supreme authority. Until the states became franchisees with the United States, the District of Columbia, this is where the federal government can intervene in state affairs now. Previously, they couldn't do that. And so, why? Because they accept the benefits from the United States. And so, like, for example, like child support, that's really, and this applies to many marital breakups, right? People have to pay child support, right? So that's really a federal agency. But the federal government employs states to go out and collect. And so they get a percentage of actually what's collected from the individual that actually have to pay child support. So it goes back to the United States, but it's not the United States that we've been taught that it is. It's talking about the District of Columbia, which is a corporation. And the birth certificate made me a corporation, made you a corporation. So when you go into your marriage, your corporation. And so an example, and a lot of people, I know you're going to find this extremely difficult to comprehend. A lot of people don't believe it until they do something like want to get a weapon, right? So in many states still, when you want to get a weapon, you have to get a permit. And when you define the word permit, you're essentially asking someone for permission. So why do I have to ask for permission for a right to protect myself? Rights are inherited from the creator. Privileges are granted to you by someone of high authority, like a right to drive, right? If you're a marital person, you go and get a driver's license. Driver's license is a contract, right? So if I sign up for that contract, so now I'm like substituting my right to travel with a privilege to drive. And so now I believe that I need this piece of plastic to go from point A to point B. If I don't need a piece of plastic to walk outside to go to the corner store, then why do I need it if I'm in my conveyance? It's because of these contracts that we sign up, right? We sign into. So if I start calling it a car or a motor vehicle, now it's something different. When you look up these terms, they carry a different meaning. So I need a driver's license to operate a motor vehicle, right? But I don't need it for a conveyance if it's my private conveyance. What I do with my property is my business. There's a maximum law that states that no man has more of a right to your property than you yourself, right? But when we sign these contracts, whether it's marital contracts or what have you, that governs our lives. So now in marriages, it brings, and one of the number one causes of breakups is the inflictions of commerce, right? The reasons, one of the number one reasons that marriages don't last is because of financial problems. Financial problems will rip your marriage apart. So in order to have finances, what do you got to do? You got to work. So they tell you, hey, if you want to earn more, you got to work more. You got to work harder. And so the harder you work, the more they tax you and the less time you can spend with your significant other. So now, what's the feedback from that? It causes problems in your marriages. So you're at work so much. When you really think about it, most people at work more than they are with their significant other. At a minimum, you may spend, if you're working full time, 40 hours a week. And so you got to add into that the time that it requires you to travel to and from work. So you're at work at least, if you're working full time, 8 hours a day. So a lot of people are developing these work spouses, right? You have like a work wife, a work husband, because you're there so much. And then when you come home, you don't get to spend a lot of time because you're so worn out. You're broken down from working so much. So you come home, you spend like maybe 1 or 2 hours with your spouse, your significant other, a little bit of time with your children. It's time to go to bed, go to sleep. Now, most people don't do that. They used to be watching television, but now they're on social media. Social media created one of the worst venues that could possibly exist for relationships, if you're going to be loyal, right? Because, I mean, so many people have actually committed adultery in social media, on social media, right? Because if I'm an honorable person and I'm communicating with someone else on social media, even though you may not have actually had sex with them, usually if you have the time and that social media relationship progress is going to eventually happen. So when your significant other finds out that you've been on social media talking to all of these people, like you got kind of like a social media relationship with, you know, someone that you really shouldn't. And so the reason that the sexual act hasn't taken place, just haven't had time yet. But it would have if you had enough time. So you're already really cheating, like when you engage in these kind of relationships. Because my belief is that if you put the opposite sex together long enough, something may occur that you regret. I know a lot of women that say, oh, he's just a friend. But let me be honest with you about men. Men always have an ulterior motive. Even if he lies, the man usually has an ulterior motive. If he thinks a woman is attractive, even though he may not voiced that to her at the inception of the engagement, he'll generally wait until she's in some sort of emotional state. It could take years because a lot of guys are not confident. It could take years for him to voice it. But when he believes that she's emotionally vulnerable, then he'll bring it forth and try and make his move. And then some women, they yield to that and regret it later. They say, oh, we shouldn't have done that. This can't happen again. But it eventually brings a demise to the relationship because some people, they can't come back from infidelity. Yeah.
Okay. That was so much all in one. So thank you for that. And I think we always talk about aphasia.
Right.
And maybe you can speak to that. Like, as people receive your information, what usually happens?
Right. First of all, when people get the information, it usually causes some sort of breach with a lot of family members. What I've learned is that when people embrace this sort of information that's not readily available to the general public, and you find a lot of people out there trying to teach this, but everyone is not really sound in this information. There's a lot of scammers out there. So you got to do your due diligence and research everything. Research everything. Mm-hmm. I challenge anyone, any listener, to research everything that I'm saying right here. But you got to be very careful. But when people receive the information, they're kind of like just astonished, right? It's like, no, this can't be true. And I've had various people, in fact, the deluge of people say, wow, man, I thought you was lying, but I went and checked out everything that you said. And I found the law and I validated. So it's the truth. I just can't believe it's been hidden from me for all of this time, my entire life. Like, life is not what we, think, like what we're told. So it's just totally the opposite of what most of us has actually been told. But, and so I say that most people suffer from aphasia. And so essentially what that means is that most of us, since we've been taught to speak in colloquial speech and common parlance, when we read things in legalese or in a legal language, we don't comprehend it. So the words don't really mean what we've actually been taught in common parlance. So I call it aphasia. And so that means we've lost the ability to be able to properly use and comprehend words. It's aphasia. So, for instance, we'll read something like a person, right? In common parlance, a person is just like, I'm talking, it's a man or a woman. That's what we was taught. You go and read that in the language of law, you find out that a person could be like a corporation. It could be like a LLC. It could be a, that's a person. But it could also mean like you or I that has his own business that he's not aware of, known as a corporation. So that takes us back to the birth certificate again. So mostly when you look at the birth certificate, the name is written in all capital letters. Now, when something is written in all capital letters, and you can confirm this, you could just go and read Chicago Style Manual. It shows you how things are written. And when you're looking up a corporation, it's generally always written in all capital letters, right? And so you got to wonder why. It's my name written in all capital letters on the birth certificate, on the driver's license, on the social security card, on almost any governmental ID. Now, since so many people has been like bringing this to the forefront, what I've noticed is that some of them's actually gotten slick. And on the birth certificate, they're writing it in upper and lower case. So we can't get so caught up into how it's written, but it's the meaning behind it. And so sometimes you'll get like offers from a court. Their first correspondence would generally be in all capital letters. But once they've gotten you to contract with them, they might respond back with the upper and lowercase name because you're already contracting them now. You're under their jurisdiction. Or one of the other tricks that they have is they refer to you as Mr. Smith. Did your father name you Mr.? Did your mama name you Mr.? No. So whenever you see Mr. in front of a name, that name is really essentially a corporation. They've incorporated the name. When you see an abbreviation like Donald J. Trump, an abbreviation signifies a corporation. A man's name, a woman's name is written in upper and lower case, right? That's how it's written properly. If they put the last name first, that is referring to a corporation. So it's so much that we don't know. It's called aphasia. We don't have the ability to understand this. And so the only way that we could actually really be successful is to unlearn almost everything that we know and go and teach ourselves. I contend that self-education is the best education. And so is it any wonder that about 1%, I'm not even go out and say two, I would say 1% of the population essentially controls the entire world. How are they able to do this? It's because they're writing things that we don't understand, and they use something known as divide and conquer. Now the new thing, another reason there's so many reasons and problems in relationships is that the man has been turned against the woman and the woman against the man. And so the system pretends that it's for the women, but they are essentially using the women as a catalyst to destroy the nuclear family. Because now, I mean, statistically, I mean, it's obvious when you look at it that single parenting has been detrimental to the rearing of children. It's just, well, you could go and check out the statistics yourselves. Single parenting has been detrimental. And so the way that the system is set up, approximately about 90% of child custody cases are won by women. But statistically, when you look at it, single parent men generally raise children that is less likely to be in the penal system. The suicide rate is lower. The teenage pregnancy rate is lower. There's the drug abuse, substance abuse is lower. So then why are they giving it to the single woman? Things that make you go, hmm. And so they're giving it to her because they want the woman to believe that the system is in favor of her. But the system is not in favor of any of us. It's just a method of divide and conquer to destroy the nuclear family, which is a relationship. So now they're promoting, like, hey, pretty much individuality. So the family is the backbone of a nation. So if you don't have a family, then you can't properly build a nation. So they're destroying it at its foundation by promoting the singleness and relationships. And so a lot of people are pretty much ending up miserable. And so unless you earn somewhere around 80 to 100,000, a single person won't make it in the end anyways, because their salary is just not enough to retire on. So in the end, you're seeing these people that's going back to work. You're seeing elderly people in places like Walmart standing as greeters, and they're 70 years old. That's what single parenting does.
Yeah, and just to, I guess, the big thing that I want to portray here is the knowledge is the power, right? And once you become aware, how do you come back to power? And I think you can certainly speak to that in your own life and what you've been through. So maybe you could talk about once you receive this information, or I wouldn't necessarily say receive. I mean, you studied hours and hours of work. And so could you maybe speak to you could certainly speak to your success rate, and then also how you can help people.
So I was I surmise I was what they would consider to be successful. So initially, I started with a degree in architectural. So my pretty after high school, my first job was actually a professional job. So I worked in like architectural engineering, and I went to school for that at first. But I was fairly young, so I was hanging out and, you know, coming into work late, falling asleep at the desk. So, you know, the owner of the business, he said, "Hey, what's going on? You know, you're falling asleep a lot here." And so I didn't really care anything about it. He said, "We're going to put you out with the surveyors." After he warned me certain times. And so I was like, "I'm not going out to do that. I don't want to work with my hands. I want to work with my mind." So when he did that, I quit. So I quit the job, went back. I'm doing a labor job, just hanging out and partying, right? Me and my cousin. So then eventually from there, I decided I let my mom talk me into going into the military. And, you know, that was quite an experience. That was good. You know, I went into special operations. But in the military, I got to see different things. Like, and I saw a lot of things I really didn't agree with. Like, because, you know, I was on, like, the special operation unit. So I got to see a lot of things that the typical soldier didn't see. So I stayed in the military 8 years, but towards the end, I got out. And so I still had 3 years on my contract when I got out, because I started waking up. There was this guy that I met in the military, and he gave me some things to read, and I said, "Oh, whoa." I just started researching. And so I was like, a lot of this stuff is not just, so I need to get out of here. So I put in what is known as a conscientious objector. And so that means my conscience objected to certain things that I was actually seeing. And so they took me, they had me to be interviewed by a chaplain. I had to get interviewed by my company commander, by the post commander, and even a psychiatrist. And so they was like, "Well, you found him sincere in his beliefs." So they let me out with an honorable discharge with 3 years left on the contract. Got out of the military, I went back to college, and this time I majored in computer science. So I graduated from that, and I got a degree in computer science. And then I tried to get jobs, couldn't do it. So I had to, you know, just go and work for free for a few people. And then that wasn't enough. So I had to go and get certifications. They was like, "Yeah, you got a degree, but you don't have no experience. So you got to get certifications." So now I had to study for these 7 Microsoft exams. So I eventually passed those. Now I'm a Microsoft certified system engineer. Then I also got the Network Plus and A Plus. So now I finally land a job in the computer field. And so, I'm working. And I work for some of the major corporations like Verizon, Microsoft, the big Dell. I work for them. And several different jobs. I was a manager of a help desk. And then I was a network administrator for Kings County in Brooklyn. And so that was, and I had worked in this field probably like about 8 years now. And so that was my breaking point, because I started to realize, and I was getting paid pretty good. And I was actually also a computer architectural instructor for John Jay College in New York. That's like a, that's a law school, right? Where you go to get like a law, it's John Jay. But I was like, damn, you know, I'm getting paid okay, but I don't have no time. I can't do anything. And they always have me on call. So I always had to have like a phone where they could reach me, and I could never go anywhere that was 2 hours out of the radius. I was always on call. And plus that, I was on salary. So they could work me as much as they wanted to. And there was no increase in my pay. So I was like, I got to do something else. So I was like, I'm going to resign. And so now my cousin, I went over one day and he was studying something about law. He was watching these videos on law. I was like, well, that's interesting. What's that? So I started researching this stuff. And I started looking at these people that were supposed to be gurus. And they're talking about the law, right? From a different perspective. They're talking about common law. I was like, wow, this is some interesting stuff. Let's get some. And so one thing just led me to another, and I started listening to this one guy named Robert Manure. He's out of Canada. And he was, he had something called 86 is your fix. What is this guy talking about? And then he mentioned something about a Black Lawyer's Dictionary. So I started looking up Black Lawyer's Dictionary. I looked at us. Damn, this thing is expensive. It's almost $1,000. And so I literally found one, and he was saying to get the fourth edition. So I didn't just listen to one guy. I listened to someone else. He was saying similar things, but they all had different perspectives, right? So I was like, I'll get the books and research it myself. So I invested into a Black Lawyer's Dictionary. Then I invested into like all of these different law books and started reading them and And like, wow, I started looking up these U.S. codes. I said, wow, this stuff is like really interesting. And then I just got consumed with it. Like once I started researching this stuff, I didn't want to stop. But the problem was I had a job. So I could only study this stuff late at night. So I would fall asleep trying to research this stuff. And so I came to the conclusion, I said, I'm going to have to quit my job. And I wouldn't recommend anyone do this. So I eventually, like, I went in and I told the my director, I'm going to resign. He said, well, you can't resign. You're the only one that was able to set up the network in this company. I said, yeah, I quit. He said, if you quit right now, you're never going to have another job in New York City. I said, yeah, I don't intend to do that anymore. I think I'm going to be an entrepreneur. And so he said, okay, but you're going to never work in New York City again. So I quit. I quit the job. And so when I quit, you know, I had some money saved up. But when you're you don't have a source of income coming in, that money becomes depleted, like, really fast. So I started, like, doing personal trainers, because I was actually a personal trainer also, trying to do private sessions that should kind of bring some money in. Then I started like repairing computers on the side and so on and so forth. And so I was doing okay. But then I got in a relationship with this female, and she was living out of state. She was living in North Carolina. And she was like, I'll move here and so on and so forth. And so eventually I kind of trusted that, and I moved down there. And when I got there, things weren't the way that she told me they were. Like, she was going through a foreclosure, and I'm like, whoa, you didn't tell me this. So I was only there with her for like maybe 2 weeks. And then we ended up having to get an apartment because her place was going through a foreclosure. But at the same time, I'm learning this law stuff. So now I'm getting to test this stuff out. So I tried to like help her with the foreclosure. And so I told her, don't move out of the place. Don't move out of the place no matter what, because possession is 9/10 of the law. But what happened is that when the sheriff came over, she moved out. And so I told her, I put a warrant against the sheriff's department. You don't have to move out of the place. But she moved anyway. She's got intimidated. And so the long and the short of that is that she ended up, like, a couple months later, that the whole property debt got discharged on the property. And so, and they even sent her a check with a refund. And she's like, oh, this worked. I said, yeah, but you already gave your house up. So she had already given the house up, and someone else had actually bought the house. Someone else is in there now. So now she's like, wow, this stuff really works. And so, wow, yeah, it really did work. And so she and I end up breaking up. And I don't know nobody in North Carolina. I don't have no family there. And so when she and I broke up, I kind of like end up homeless, you know? So I'm living out of my car. And so I was like, you know what? I'm just going to suck this up. And I just started studying. Like, all of my time just went into studying and reading. I mean, I'm like up all night studying and reading. And then once I got to a place where I felt that I could actually teach this, I was teaching people for free for about 2.5-3 years. Me and a couple other guys. Back then, they had what is known as talk show. So I left North Carolina. I went back to New York. And we started doing shows on talk show. We was actually helping people for free. And so a lot of people started getting remedied. So the problem with that is that, hey, I have to make a living. So then I started charging people for my time and energy. It's like, I'm not charging you to do it. I'm charging you for the time that it requires me to do it. And so from, like, I guess, like 2015 forward, you know, I just actually been doing this, like just helping people. And so I kind of like turned it into a business. Essentially, I started off as a sole proprietor, but then I just turned it into an LLC, because a sole proprietor is just, it was just like getting ripped off, like just too high in taxes and so on and so forth. So I just decided to make it official. And so I went from probably making like $80,000 a year to eventually about $150,000 to about $200,000. Then I just started everything I'm learning, the books that I read when I learned this stuff, it was so complex. So what I decided to do, I said, I'm going to try and break this down in the most simplistic manner as possible. So the things that I was learning, I started writing books. And the first book that I wrote was called The Infliction of Commerce. And in that book, I was talking about how everything that we're involved with, all of the problems that we're literally having in life, in our relationships, in our marriages, usually comes from the infliction of commerce. Commerce is usually involved. Like, if we really look at it, most of the problems that we're having comes from some commerce we don't have. Our marriages, it ruins marriages, it ruins other relationships, can't take trips because of commerce. The reason that we're forced to have jobs that we don't want, when you look at surveys, most people are working on jobs that they don't even like, but they go on doing it anyways because they've been engendered to believe that if I quit my job, I won't be able to survive. So we're doing things that we don't like because we're locked into some contract and some mindset, right? We're locked into some mindset where we believe that if I leave here, I won't be able to make it. We're afraid to take risks. And so it keeps us locked in. So the job that occupies most of our time, so we can't do the things that we should do. Because if people could actually take the time to study and read, they can learn it just like I do. But they don't have the time. And the system makes sure that we don't have that time because of our jobs. And then if we don't devote the rest of the time to our relationships, it's going to destroy the relationship. So the job kind of like governs everything. And that job comes with a contract. If we take too much time off, we lose the job. Now we don't have any finances. Now it ruins our relationship again. Because let's face it, no one's going to be in a relationship where, you know, especially a female, where the guy's not bringing some source of income. Doesn't matter how she feel about him in the beginning. Eventually, if she's looking after this guy, he's not bringing in any kind of income, relationship dies. Even if the relationship was good, if he had a good relationship, if he loses the job, the relationship eventually ends, right? It's just in her genetic makeup. The relationship's going to eventually be brought to a demise. And so instead of him going out and chasing his dream, he works for someone else. And so when we go into a job, we're making that person rich, right? So what's the guy, Zuckerberg? People that work for Facebook, they help make Zuckerberg rich, right? Not themselves. So we could never, the conclusion that I came to is I could never earn the things that I want as long as I'm working for someone else. I'm going to be always limited, and I'm going to always give them that control over me. And if they can have control over me, they can have control over my loved ones, my relationship, and everything. Because if you take away money, then what do you have? Now, I'm not saying that, hey, we should love money, because the love of money is the root of all evil. But you need it to function in society, because that's what they designed. They designed a society where commerce is essential. Money is essential to survive. And since there's no real money, you know, you have this money of account. If you don't have it, you won't survive. It's impossible to survive without it. So they made it essential. And so, and they control how we get it. And so the only way to really be successful is to learn what they've done. And so I believe that if we could actually like learn how someone did something, we could also undo it. And that's what I've learned how to do. I've learned how they locked us into these contracts So it's always true, right? Which is true on one side, it's also true on the other. Like, it's a yin and a yang, right? It's the opposite. You can't have good without bad. You can't have bad without good. Because how would I know what bad is unless I knew good? How would I know what good is unless I knew bad? So you can't have on one side of the equation a solution unless there's a problem on the other. So what is a problem? A problem is just a question that needs to be answered. So instead of looking at them as problems, I decided to look at it as this is an opportunity, right? So if we don't look at it as a problem, if we look at it as an opportunity, we have an opportunity to change it, right? And so that's what I did. Okay, this is how they did it. I do just the opposite. And so I undo it. And that's true of anything. If we found out how the problem occurred, if we look at the other side of the equation, this is how it was actually created. This is how we could undo it by going to the opposite side. So I undid it. And so since the birth certificate was a contract that put me under their control, their jurisdiction, another word for jurisdiction is control and authority. So if I go into a court or anywhere, and if someone automatically have jurisdiction over me, they tell me you need a permit for a weapon. Okay, you have freedom of speech, but you could only speak when you get a permit at this particular time. And so that's not really freedom of speech. That's control. That's jurisdiction. Because if I go out there and I haven't registered to speak, then they're going to send their minions out and say, hey, you're not authorized to be here. So then I really don't have freedom of speech. But I have freedom of speech, but just watch what you say. Because if I say certain things, now they're going to charge me with this and that. But words don't hurt anyone, because we have a decision to determine whether or not a word is going to hate us, right? So I believe that someone that is a member of a Nazi group should have a freedom of speech. If he wants to call me the N-word, that's his right, right? Because if I infringe on his rights, what does that do? That's going to give them the ability to take away my rights as well. He's just speaking. So as long as you don't do anything, but once we give the government the authority to control their freedom of speech, we're also giving them that same authority to control ours, right? Once they can control it, it's no longer free speech. And that's what they're doing. You post certain things on social media now, it's censored. Well, you can't say that here. You can't say that. So now their freedom of speech has actually been pretty much almost taken away. But they still tell you that you have it, right? But once we allow them to invoke, hey, well, you can say this, but you can't say that, we've pretty much lost our freedom. And how do we do that? You do it with these contracts. Contracts, contracts, contracts. How do we do that with contracts? We sign up. When I go to YouTube, there's an adhesion contract that says, you can't say this, you can't say that, you can't say that, if you want to be a member. So people turn around and try to sue YouTube. Why are they not successful? They signed the contract. Well, you don't like it, but you... They say, well, if you don't want to be able to... if you want to be able to say these things, you can't be a member of YouTube. Can't be a member of Facebook, right? Because you're a member. You have a membership, which is a contract. And so as far as the success... So since I've actually been, like, really doing this stuff for myself... I've been much more well off financially than working for someone in the system, because now I can vacation when I want to. If I don't feel like working a particular day, I can do it. If I want to pick up and go somewhere on the drop of the dime, I can do it. All I need is a computer or a phone to work. I can do it. I can take coaching course. I can do it. I couldn't do that when I was working in the system. And there's nothing like that kind of freedom. And that's the freedom that they don't want you to have. So is the money that they govern us with really necessary? Not really. Because you have skills, I have skills. And if everyone was to barter their skills, there would be no need for money. Because they use this money to control us, right? They use money to control us and determine who's going to get what, who's going to earn what specific amount. And we believe that we can't make it without it. But I contend that we can. We have that drive and an indomitable spirit, then we can.
Yeah, and also I think coming back to, we're all creators of our experience.
Yep, we have the brush. We have the canvas. You can paint hell, or you can paint paradise. But you can't blame me.
Right. And that's another thing too, like owning what you created.
Right.
Being, you know, like coming back to, you know, everything that I did, you know, I can own it, as compared to, I think in society, a lot of people believe in the power of the victim or the martyr, where, you know, and there is a power to being a victim, but there's a greater power in owning your results. And I think, you know, what I've seen of you, and it's only been a few years, what I certainly really commend about you is the fact that you always own your results, because you know the power of that and the power of your creation. So yeah, I think that's a great way to end this conversation. I will put your information in the description box, wherever I put this. I'm on YouTube, I'm on Rumble. I might put this on LinkedIn and Alignable. So yeah, thank you so much for coming on. And is there anything else you would like to say?
Yeah, I just want to end with this. I would just like to end with this. I believe it was Aristotle that says, the only thing I know is that I don't know anything. And I would like to say this for people that, you know, that need help with coaching, life coaching, dating coaching. You know, in my case, if you want to undo those contracts, you got to do revocations of powers of attorneys and so on and so forth. To people that say, well, I don't want to pay for this, I'll say this. People that don't want to pay for knowledge, a lot of people like to use that phrase, knowledge is free, right? People that don't want to pay for knowledge will always pay more for not having it. And I reiterate that. People that don't want to pay for knowledge will always pay more for not having that knowledge. She has abandonment
issues. So true. Let them go, man. Don't want to keep them, man. Stop trying to cut. Okay, well, thank you so much. Stop trying to see. And we'll see you next time on Bow of the Heart. And a lot of dudes are like that. A lot of these men, John, is out here. You're acting like a broad. You're overly emotionally. Yo, get your mind right. You're overly emotional, man. Wounded heart. Damaged goods.